Good evening, and thank you for inviting me to share some of my views, which might not be well suited to conventional wisdom, but since I'm in the thick of the battle, I do not have the luxury of making outside observations. When murders happen, they happen within the radius of my eyesight and the pain of my life. So there is a difference from where I come from. Most of you must have heard of the best-selling American author Khalid Hosseini. For 2 years, his book has been on the top, and that position there suggests that the United States of America is not a country hostile to Muslims or Islam. The most highest-selling poet in that country is Rumi, and the most popular man in that country is Muhammad Ali, and nobody as yet has demonstrated to dismiss Farid Zakaria from CNN. Coming back to Khalid Hosseini, in his book, A Thousand Splendid Sons, there's a character called Nana, a poor unwed mother. And in the first part of the book, she tells her 5-year-old daughter, Mariam, spelt Mariam for American readers, and this is what she says, and I quote, "Learn this now and learn it well. Like a compass needle that points north, a man's accusing finger always finds a woman. Always. You remember that, Mariam." In 30 words, Hosseini sums up the way how men govern the lives of women in the world of Islam. Like Mariam, millions of Muslim girls are told very early in life by their mothers, their place in society is one of submission. Submission not to God, as said in the Quran, but submission to man. No other institution confers the status of submission and possession more than the niqab or even the hijab, the piece of cloth that today stands as a defining symbol of Islam. Failure of Muslim women to submit to the supposed Islamic attire can lead to serious consequences, and I give you an example. This is a letter sent by a Palestinian group called the Swords of Islamic Righteousness. I love the names that come from the Middle East. Swords, you know, you got. It's like the Russian cavalry is coming charging down. The letter sent to TV newscasters in Gaza said, and I quote, "You are without shame or morals." Now, if that was enough, I would have said, yeah, hear that every day. The jihadis then say, addressing their sisters who work for Palestinian television in Gaza, demanding that the women start wearing Islamic attire, the group threatened that if they did not see heads covered, the Swords of Islamic Righteousness would, and I quote, "cut their throats from vein to vein if needed to protect the spirit and the morals of the nation." The threat was sent as text message to Lana Shaheen, a prominent TV host. Even though she was rattled by the message, Shaheen remained defiant. "I am taking the threats very seriously, but I will not start wearing the hijab," she told reporters. However, that was in June 2007. Subsequently, within a month, Gaza fell to the gunmen of Hamas, and the agenda of the Swords of Islamic Righteousness came into effect. Today, no woman can be seen in Gaza without a head cover. The Islamist obsession with a woman's attire can have deadly consequences. On March 15, 2002, Saudi Arabia's religious police stopped schoolgirls from leaving a blazing school building in the holy city of Mecca because the girls were not wearing appropriate Islamic attire. Because the Mutawain, which is the religious fascist police, 15 girls perished in the blaze while 50 more suffered serious burns. An eyewitness said he saw 3 religious policemen, quote, beating young girls to prevent them from leaving the schools because they were not wearing the abaya and their heads would turn men into sexual excitement. The school was locked at the time of the fire, a usual practice to ensure full segregation of the sexes. The police, known as the Commission for Promotion of Virtue and Prevention of Vice, stopped men who tried to help the girls, warning It is a sin to approach those girls because their heads are not covered. What is it about this piece of cloth that triggers so much self-righteous angst amongst Muslims? What is about a woman's face or her hair, the most inanimate part of her body, that arouses so much passion among some Muslim men? Moreover, why would so many Muslim women, educated and supposedly enlightened, submit to the dictates of the men in their lives, their husbands, their brothers, their sons, and of course, the clerics and the male scholars for centuries who have laid down the law for these females? How could the covering of a woman's head or face, a requirement that does not merit explicit mention in the Quran, end up as the most defining symbol of Islam? And what is the rationale behind the Islamist obsession? Will God really be offended if a woman shows a bit of her bangs? Though carefully concealed, the true agenda of the Islamists is to promote fear of not wearing the hijab among young Muslim girls, some of them as young as 5. This was on full display during the infamous Taekwondo controversy in Quebec in the spring of 2007. At the start of the tournament, a team of young Muslim girls sponsored by the Muslim Community Center of Montreal Mosque refused to participate because they were not allowed to wear the hijab and were told to wear the helmets. The organizers insisted that the rules of the game did not permit anything other than the prescribed helmets, and since the helmets covered the girls' hair more than the hijab, there was no need for it. The parents of the young girls, as well as a coach from the mosque, refused to allow the girls to participate. The team, made up of girls between the ages of 8 and 12, went home. One of them had the courage, 11-year-old Bisan Mansour. She told reporters, and I quote, "I feel very sad. We practiced so hard. We pulled out for a useless reason." The next day, the news was on the front pages of all Canadian papers. Islamist groups sounded exhilarated. The incident had given them one more opportunity to drive home the propaganda among vulnerable Muslim youth that Canada is essentially an anti-Muslim country and that Muslim youth are the targets. What went unreported by the newspapers was the fact that even under the harshest interpretation of Sharia, Muslim girls below the age of puberty are not required to cover their heads. Here was an 8-year-old girl being forced to wear a hijab, and not a single reporter or columnist dared to challenge the parents or the mosque. There was another twist to the story that also went unreported. In a message posted on the website of this mosque addressed to the girls, the mullah says, "If the young girls took off their hijab, they could end up having," and I'm quoting the exact words, "illegitimate children." One can only imagine the trauma of a 10-year-old girl being warned of possible rape if she was not dressed appropriately. The mosque website listed, this is fascinating, advantages of observing religious attire, which included, among other things, and I quote, "guarding oneself from the lustful looks of men." The mosque also then listed the disadvantages of discarding, read the connivance of the language, the disadvantages of discarding the hijab. These included, number one, divorce, adultery, rape, illegitimate children. Number two, stresses, insecurity, suspicion in the minds of husbands, ultimately disturbing the familial harmony. Number four, instigating young people to deviate from the deviate towards the path of lust and immorality. If the threat of rape and fear of illegitimate children were not enough, these preteen girls were told if they took off the hijab, they would cease to be Muslims. The reason why I brought up these two or three issues is that as much as well-meaning, good in acting in good faith, non-Muslim folks of the liberal left try to accommodate, they walk straight into the path, the trap that has been set for them to ensure that the Islamist infiltration in this country becomes a permanent part. Today we have a situation where this blackmail of young women and the beating up of young girls by their younger brothers and the positioning of male people outside young girls' schools is ubiquitous. Anyone denying that is not talking the truth. And counselors in this room who deal with women who are hurt, people like Aruna Pap will tell you that. There's a 6-month waiting list to talk to these girls who have bruises on their backs, who are striped and beaten up and dare not walk out of the house. We as a Muslim group, and I'm talking the Muslim Canadian Congress, believe that there is willful misrepresentation on this issue. Islamists promoting the burqa and niqab have employed the tactic of labeling their critics as anti-Islam, Islamophobic, right-wing racist, neocon, Zionist agents, paid by Mossad, Israeli agents, anything but Muslim. What they've done effectively is, in the name of freedom of speech, they have blackmailed the most enlightened aspects of Muslim civilization into a silence that in the last 1400 years has never been more stifling. And who do they rely on? They rely on the well-meaning, decent Canadian folks who are willing to pay $10 million when somebody else commits a crime. A people who are willing to let those who went to Afghanistan go to the Supreme Court and say we got mistreated in a dictatorship in Syria, which we had nothing to do. And yet we stand there as silent chamberlains, wishing the problem to go away, one step at a time. We defeated Hitler in 5 years. In 10 years, we have not even understood the war that we are fighting. And we are so ignorant and so cowardly that because we cannot understand it, we say, let's accommodate them. Let me suggest to you, ladies and gentlemen, gender apartheid, misogyny, homophobia, and the notion that Jews and Christians can be killed because God ordained us to do that are serious indications of what would happen if we do not allow to distinguish, if we do not distinguish between two sets of thinkings. It is Islam versus Islamism. It is Muslims versus Islamists. The rest of you can only help from the sidelines. Thank you very much.